When I was a boy living in Dawson City on the Klondike, it never occurred to me that I was living in a very strange town indeed. As far as I was concerned, this famous Gold Rush city with its abandoned dance halls and its wooden sidewalks was just another town. It didn't occur to me that the climate and the history and the geography and the people were all unique. It's true that the temperature dropped to 60 below zero every winter and the wolves howled across the hills just behind our house, but this all seemed quite normal to me. We went to school in the pitch dark, and we came home in the pitch dark, and we didn't see the sun at all for 6 full weeks. But it never occurred to me that the rest of the world wasn't the same. In the summer, the sun shone until 11 o'clock at night, and then it rose again at 2 o'clock in the morning, and it was as bright as day at midnight. That didn't seem strange at all. Dawson City was a town big enough to hold 30,000 people, and in fact it once held that number. But when I lived there, it only held 1,000 people. And yet it never occurred to me that I was living in a ghost town. The buildings were all almost 40 years old, and they looked like something out of a Wild West movie, with the false fronts and bay windows and ornately carved balconies. You know the kind I mean. You've seen them in the movies. Most of them were empty. They had been dance halls and gambling houses, saloons, etc., in the gaudy days of the old Klondike Gold Rush. This didn't seem unusual to me either. I was born among them. The people in town, most of them were men and women who'd taken part in that fabulous mass movement to the Yukon in 1897 and 1898, climbing up the icy steps of the mountain passes and building their crude boats and floating down the Yukon River to the land of gold. My father was one of them. He used to talk about the days when he clawed his way up the Chilkoot Pass with its steps of solid ice. And I remember how he told me of that black line of moving men. You've probably seen pictures of it. And how that slow line of men never stopped, and how sometimes a man would slip out of line from fatigue or accident, and then he'd have to wait on the sidelines for hours before there was a place in that line again. Then my father would tell how he built an enormous raft on the shores of Lake Bennett. That's a beautiful green glacial lake high up in the mountains where the Yukon River rises. There were thousands and thousands of men on its shores in the winter of 1897-98, and when the ice broke in the lake with a great roar, my father and the thousands of other men launched their rafts and their boats and their scows, and off they went, floating off down the river for 500 miles across lakes and through rapids until they reached Dawson City, where the boats were tied up 6 deep for a mile and a half along the shoreline. I remember my father telling me how in the 30-mile river, which is very dangerous but very blue and very clear, he had looked over the edge of the raft beneath the waters and seen a sunken scow with 30 dead cattle trapped aboard it. You saw all sorts of strange sights in those days. Well, as I say, none of these things seemed out of the ordinary to me because I was brought up in this atmosphere. It wasn't until I began to do research for my book about the Klondike Gold Rush that I began to realize what a fantastic business it all was and what a strange town my hometown of Dawson City had turned out to be. Well, you know, a lot of people think about the Klondike. They think it's in Alaska. Of course, that's not so. It's in the Yukon Territory of Canada, and it's only a few miles south of the Arctic Circle. In 1897 and 1898, when the Gold Rush took place, it must have seemed a very long way off indeed, because that was the days before the airplane, of course. In those days, the Yukon River was hardly known, although it's more than 2,000 miles long, and it's the fifth largest river in North America. It lay hidden away behind the tallest mountains on the continent, a dark, silent watercourse flowing through an empty country populated only by Indians and wolves, scarcely marked on the maps. And some of the maps had it wrong. Well, you can imagine what a tremendous change occurred in just 1 year when, I suppose there were 60,000 men and women and even children who fought their way into this country and started digging for gold, or trying to. It changed the North. All this happened 60 years ago, but everywhere you go today in Alaska, the Yukon, and the Mackenzie River country in northern British Columbia and so on, you can still see the faint tracks of these Klondikers. There's a little narrow gauge railway that threads its way through the mountains of the White Pass from the Pacific Ocean to Whitehorse at the head of the Yukon. And if you go up there and look out of the train window, you can still see a worn trail beside the tracks. It's still there, and that trail is, of course, the Trail of 98. And all through the north, you can come on similar trails and cabins, yes, and graves, too, and old boats and old mines that mark the various pathways that led to the Klondike. I remember when I worked in a mining camp in the Klondike country a few years ago, and every morning after work, I used to take a walk down the valley, and everywhere I looked, there were relics of that gold rush a half a century before. Thousands of rusty picks and shovels, the rotting remains of ancient sluice boxes, wheelbarrows everywhere, mound after mound of gravel tailing piles, crumbling log cabins lined with newspapers from the days of 98, old bedsprings, tools, pieces of machinery, furniture, everything. That's when I first began to realize that the story of the Klondike is one of the most fascinating chapters in our history. And so I started talking to the old-timers who were still left alive to get their stories, and reading the old newspapers such as the Klondike Nugget and the Midnight Sun, which were published in the days of the Gold Rush. But on this record, I do want to tell you something about the Klondike and Dawson City and the Yukon River as it is today.